And we do this because some of us don't have study like we ought to. Right. We use every excuse in the book not to pick up the book. We use every excuse that I am either too busy, I'm either too tired, or I just got too much going on as a reason why we don't study God's word the way we should. Yes. And whenever you don't study God's word the way you ought to, you're going to find yourself being weak in the face of temptation. When you don't have study like you ought to, you also find yourself being half-hearted in worship unto God. In other words, worship doesn't take top priority in your life. It's just something that you'll fit in when the opportunity arises. It's something that you know you need to do, and you'll do it as long as it's convenient for you to do it. But if worship interferes with something that you want to do, the way you know that you're half-hearted in worship to God is when you would rather do something else rather than come to worship to God. Not only that, but you only do good when it's convenient. In other words, you only take time to help somebody when it's beneficial to you. Right. You only extend the right hand of benevolence to folk when there's something in it for you. When you feel like you can get something in return, then that's when you'll do something for somebody else. That's how you know that you're not close to Jesus. Because Jesus did good to everybody and didn't look for anything in return.
Amen.
Matter of fact, in Matthew chapter 5, he taught his disciples in the Sermon on the Mount that when a man would borrow something from you, he said, give it to him.
Yes, sir.
Amen. If he asks, or if he takes you to law to sue you for your coat, Jesus said, let him have your cloak also. If he compel you to go 1 mile, Jesus said, go 2.
Yes, sir.
If he borrows from you, Jesus said, give it to him and don't you turn him away.
Yes, sir. Right, sir.
These are things that we need to constantly evaluate ourselves with to see just how far we are from Jesus. And whenever you survey your life and discover that you are a guilty distance from God, you need to make up in your mind that I've got to get to Jesus by any means necessary.
Yes, sir.
I don't know whether you realize it or not, but brothers and sisters, we need Jesus.
Yes,
some of us act like we already got him, but when we look at your life, when we look at how you talk to folk, when we look at how you treat other people, I know you need Jesus, and you need to realize that you need Jesus. When we look at how you act, we know you need Jesus, because many of you are angry, argumentative, and aggressive, and the problem is you need Jesus. Many of you are belligerent, backstabbing, and boastful, and the problem is you need Jesus. Many of you are cynical, cantankerous, and almost crazy, and the problem is you need Jesus. Many of you are dogmatic, doubtful, and dangerous, and the problem is you need Jesus. Many of you are fickle, fraudulent, and foolish, and the problem is you need Jesus. Many of you are haughty, high-minded, and hellish, and the problem is you need Jesus. Many of you are insensitive, inconsistent, and ignorant, and the problem is you need Jesus. Many of us are wishy-washy, wasteful, and wicked, and the problem is you need Jesus. And you don't need to delay your coming to Jesus any longer. You need to stop what you're doing and decide to get to him by any means necessary. In the text, in the text we find this man who decided he had to get to Jesus.
Yes, sir.
And he wasn't going to allow people. He wasn't going to allow circumstances to keep him from getting his blessing. Notice here in our text, beginning at verse number 1 of Mark chapter 2, the Bible begins to give us three things that we need to do to get to Jesus by any means necessary. Number one is found in verse number one. The Bible says that again, he entered into Capernaum.
Well,
after some days, it was noise that he was in the house.
Yes, sir.
The first thing you need to know in getting to Jesus is where Jesus is.
Yes,
hello up in heaven.
Wow.
You can't get to Jesus if you don't know where Jesus is. The Bible in this text says that Jesus was in the house. Let me tell you, as a member and a minister of the Church of Christ,
yes, sir,
Jesus is in the house.
Yes.
Let me also tell you and warn you that he's not in every house.
He's not.
Will you walk with me?
Yes, sir.
Because there are some houses that are set up this morning with folk in there.
Right.
Calling on him, Lord, Lord.
Yes, sir.
But the scripture still says, why call ye me, Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? It's not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, who's going to enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Every house ain't got Jesus in that. Why would you say that, preacher? Because in 2 John, beginning at verse number 9,
yes,
John indicates unto us that unless a man continues in the doctrine of Christ, he don't have God.
He don't.
And if the doctrine of Christ is not being taught in that house,
yes,
we're not talking about house, I'm about the church house now.
Yes, sir.
Right.
If the doctrine of Christ is not taught in that church house, then Jesus ain't in that house.
Yes,
notice what John says in 2 John, beginning in verse number 9, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God.
Yes, sir.
He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father
and the Son.
And the Son.
Yes, sir.
Jesus ain't in every house. Unless the doctrine of Christ is being taught in that house, Jesus ain't in the house.
Yes, sir.
Why would you say that, preacher? Because the Lord himself said that he was going to build his church.
He did.
And when we talk about the Lord's house, we're also talking about the Lord's church.
Amen.
You looking a little funny? 1 Timothy chapter 3.
Yes, sir.
At the beginning of verse number 15.
Is it not?
Let me show you that the house of God is the church of God. And if there is a house where the doctrine of Christ is not being taught, then Jesus is not in that house. If you don't come to Jesus, you need to know which house he's in.
Yes,
I'll just tell you, he's in his house.
Yes,
he ain't got but one house. I'll show you that here in a moment. In 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse number 15, notice Paul said, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God.
Yes.
The house of God is the church of the living God.
Yes.
Now, which church is the church of the living God? Which one is the pillar and the ground of the truth?
Show it to me.
In Matthew chapter 16 and beginning at verse number 13,
right, sir.
Jesus, as he brought his disciples into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, asked them, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? What is the grapevine talk about me, boy?
Right,
who do they say that I am?
Talk, preacher.